One thing people have noticed over the years is my work has gotten more cluttered. And I think part of the reason for that is when I was a bachelor before I got married, my place was pretty empty. And as when I was married, my wife started to bring flowers in and pots, and so they started to appear in the paintings. We have a kind of a symbiotic relationship between the way we live, I think, and the kind of work that I do, because sometimes she'll buy a pot or something, bring it in, and then I'll do a painting of it. Other times we get a certain look in our where we live, and I start to paint that.
Actually, the new book really says that, a vision of earthly happiness, because he really wants to bring something to the person. He doesn't really want to show the ugly world. He doesn't want to show the troubles that we live in, the problems that we deal with every day. He wants to bring something to the people that they can draw strength from.
Basically, I'm trying to heighten reality. A lot of artists, I think, try to look at the black side of reality. I try to look on the golden side, I guess. Normally, when I do a painting, I don't do it from on the spot. I mean, I first go someplace, I think about it, I take some photographs so that when I go back, I'll have memory of certain details, architectural details and so on. But basically, I get an idea after let's say I'm in Capri. A few months later, maybe, I'll suddenly remember some beautiful setting in Capri. I'll sketch it out, and then when I actually do the painting, I'll confer with my photographs to see what a certain shutter looked like or what a certain color was and that sort of thing.
But in the end, it will never look like that exactly,
no.
Because he'll put his own feelings in there and something that he would like to see, yet in Capri wasn't like that, you know?
I'll take out the trash cans, you know, on the little via, leaving the oleanders. People ask me why I put the sun and the moon in my paintings, and I really didn't know the answer for a while until I realized that probably it's because I wanted the work itself to have its own illumination. In a way, it's kind of like Byzantine icons, where the light is sort of coming from the painting to the viewer, as opposed to the more Renaissance theory, which is that the light shines on the painting. And I think that way, because I really truly believe that the artist is kind of a communicator from, let's say, the spiritual realm to the realistic realm via aesthetics. And so you're trying to create a kind of a, get a feeling of what's out there and bring it to earth. I think in film or in books or anything, that's what the artist's real goal is. Because there's a certain kind of, I think, especially today, I think we lack a certain harmony in our lives. And I think it's the artist's role to create that harmony.
I didn't really know what it entailed to be married to a modern day artist. I had all these visions of how beautiful life it is and what an easy time he would have. Nowadays I discover that doing all these things, you need just more than just visions. You have to deal with everyday life. And Tom is a perfectionist. He sometimes gets very gloomy and says, oh, I can't paint anymore and I don't like this anymore and I don't think I'm going to do good work. And you want to be there, you want to support him, and you want to tell him that this is the right direction that he's going, and just keep on trying. That's all people want from you. Keep on trying and do your work.
I went to Mykonos originally because it was the cheapest place to be. I just started being an artist, at least being a self-supporting one, and I couldn't afford to live the whole summer in America. And years later, I met my wife there. But during the whole process of going to Mykonos, it sort of became embedded in my soul. It's sort of the ideal fantasy island.
Plus, it's a place where you can just completely let go. You're in touch with nature, you meet all these different people, and you kind of get away from your daily routine.
the way one does color, I think, varies with one's age or with one's point on artistic continuum from the beginning to the end. When I first started painting, I think I used very bright sort of primitive colors when I was a younger child. Then I thought things had to be subtle. So for a while, in my 30s, let's say, I used a lot of brown colors, and this primarily because I was mostly interested in tone. I was mostly interested in the feeling of color, kind of like Ingmar Bergman's films, you know, that kind of brown look. Then in the last 10 years, I've noticed my color is becoming brighter and brighter. I'm really more interested in the harmony between different types of colors. I mean, I like the way, for example, in Greece, you have a white wall, and then you'll have, let's say, a blue against it and a yellow and so on, and the white almost frames the colors and makes them more brilliant. I think in Florida, the kind of the vegetation, the green vegetation performs that role, and the blue sea. But color to me is very visceral. I mean, I feel like I could almost eat it, you know, especially colors that I like. Like I love sort of the sky blue, and that color can almost, as I said, it's like eating a cookie that you really like.
I think what's so wonderful about memory, one always remembers the good stuff. And when it actually gets transposed into paintings, you really get to know the best of it, because you get all the feelings and the best parts that you remember.
Memory is a great editor, because memory really can cancel out all the bad parts. You know, when you travel yourself, that if you go to Europe and 7 or 8 hours of sitting in an airplane can be very, you say after the flight, I'll never travel again, and then about 2 days later you're ready to go. I have that a lot. I say, I'm never going to go on another trip, and then I get
also, Tom, I think you have the quest for traveling. You're always in search of finding something better, because you have this vision in your head that there's something better there, and if you don't find it, you just paint it, which is a great way of coping with life, I think.
Some of us are never satisfied, which is what Renata is always complaining about. She says, I'm never satisfied with being anywhere.
The fact that you're never satisfied maybe makes you do better work, because you're trying to strive for something better than we actually know. So
that's why I immerse myself in my painting and hide out. But in the end, you really discover, you know, when you get to be as old as I am, that paradise really exists in the way you think about life.